Hello, my dear students. Welcome again to another session of our history class. Today we are going to do theme 6, the three orders. In this chapter, we will learn about the socio-economic and political changes that occurred in Western Europe between the period 9th century and the 16th century. Now, you all know that 5th century CE refers to disintegration of the Roman Empire. So after the fall of the Roman Empire, many groups of Germanic people from the Eastern as well as the Central Europe occupied regions of Italy, Spain and France. In the absence of any unifying political force, military conflict was frequent. So the people felt the need to gather their resources and protect one's land. So land became very, very important. And social organization was now centered on the control of land. Features derived from both imperial Roman traditions and German customs were included. Christianity was the official religion of the Roman Empire from 4th century, and this survived the collapse of Rome and gradually it spread to Central as well as Northern Europe. The church became a very important institution. It was a major landholder and a political power in Europe. Society was divided into three categories: the Christian priests, the landowning nobles, and the peasants. Now we come to know about medieval ages from a number of sources. And these sources are documents that contain details of land ownership, prices and legal cases. So when people purchased land, they had a number of documents to show whom the land belonged to. So from there we could know what were the prices of the land, whether they took in single ownership or joint ownership, whether men owned more land or women owned land. So all these details we can get from that. Then churches also kept record of births, marriages, deaths, because when children were born and when they were baptized, they went to church. Marriages took place in churches, so they were registered there, and even record of death was maintained. Then there were inscriptions in church which gave information about a number of things, including the associations of traders. Then during those days, a number of songs were written on the background of what was happening in those ages. So from those songs which have been, you know, songs which have been sung by people, the nursery rhymes, all those give a picture of that period. Then there were stories written in that backdrop. So from those stories, we get to know what kind of festivals were celebrated and what other activities the community indulged in. Now, feudalism originated in France and later spread in entire Europe. Now, this is a word which is derived from German word feud, which means a piece of land. It describes the economic, legal, political and social relationship which existed in the medieval era. Now, this is a social organization which is centered on the control of land, because as we mentioned, land was a very important property. In economic sense, feudalism refers to a kind of agricultural production. And this is based on the relationship between the lords, who were the owners of the land, and the peasants who worked on that land. The peasants cultivated their own land and they also worked on the land of the lords. They performed labor services for the lords, and the lords in return, they provided military protection to the peasants. These lords also had judicial control over the peasants. Now this is the pyramidal structure of feudalism, where you can see the king at the apex. At the top is the king, then there are lords and nobles, and then there are knights, and at the lowest rung you have the common people, that is the peasants and the serfs. Now Marc Bloch is a French historian and sociologist. He authored The Feudal Society. Now, this is a work about the European and particularly the French society between the time period 900 and 1300. He He emphasized the importance of geography in shaping human history. Now, this is important because geography tells us the kind of land we are living in, the topography of that land, how rich that land is, how close it is to the water bodies. So all this affect the history, because the land is rich, more and more people will come over there. If it is accessible, there are more people coming in that area. The climate of the land affects the clothing, the lifestyle of the people. So all that geography is affecting the history of a place. It shapes the history. Unfortunately, he was shot by the Nazis in the Second World War, but he has given us a lot of important information. Here we look at how France, what we know France as today, was known some time back as Gaul. Now this Gaul was a province of the Roman Empire. Now what you see in blue, that is Gaul, it had two extensive coastlines. So you can see water bodies on the eastern side as well as the western side. It also had mountain ranges, long rivers, forests, and large tracts of plains that were suited to agriculture. The Franks, that is a Germanic tribe. Now, if you can see in green, that is the area of the Franks. Now, they gave their name to Gaul, making it France that we know today. From the 6th century, this region was kingdom ruled by Frankish or French kings who were Christian by faith. Now, the French links with the church were very, very strong. And this was strengthened when in 800, Pope Leo III gave King Charlemagne the title of the Holy Roman Emperor to show the support of the church to the king. Now this is the map of England. Across the narrow channel lay the island of England, Scotland. Now this narrow channel is the English Channel. And here you can see England in dark green, an island, and above that in light is the Kingdom of Scotland. Now in the 11th century, this was conquered by a duke by the name of William the First. He was also called William the Conqueror, from the French province of Normandy. The Angles and Saxons from Central Europe had settled in England in the 6th century, and that's how England got its name, which is a variant of Angleland. William the First, you can see this Normandy, this from this territory, he crossed this English Channel and he conquered this area of England that you see in pink. William the First distributed land to 180 Norman nobles who had migrated with him. Feudalism developed in England from the 11th century. And the present Queen of England is a descendant of William the First. We now look at the three orders. The French priests believed in the concept of people being members of one of the three orders depending on their work. So it's something like our own Indian caste system, which was depending on the work that the people did or the profession of the people. A bishop stated, some pray, others fight, still others work. Thus, the three orders of society were broadly the clergy, that is the ones who pray, the nobility are the ones who fight, and still others who work are the peasantry. Because in those days, the common profession was agriculture. So the common people were all peasants. Abbess Hildegard of Bingen wrote, God makes distinctions among his flock, in heaven as on earth. So all are loved by him, yet there is no equality between them, equality among them, because they are all doing different kind of work, but that doesn't mean that God doesn't love them. He loves them equally, but there is discrimination because of the kind of work that they do. Now we look at the first order, that is the clergy. What you can see in this picture are the bishops and the priests who are part of the clergy. The medieval Catholic Church was a very important institution in those days. The Catholic Church had its own laws. The church owned lands given by rulers, and a lot of endowments were made by even rich people. Church collected taxes, they were called tithe, and it was 1/10 of the share of the produce. The head of the church was called Pope, and he lived in Rome. Christians all over Europe were guided by bishops and clerics, because the Pope was in Rome. So all other people in Europe, if they needed any guidance, it was provided by the bishops and other priests and clerics. Most villages had their own church, so people would gather every Sunday for common prayer. The priests and bishops. The priests gave sermon and led the prayer in the church. These priests had their own land. The qualification to become a priest, of course, was one would be well versed in the religious texts, but they could not belong from the community of serfs, and even women were not allowed to become priests, and physically challenged also could not become priests. It's much later that women have started becoming priests. Men who became priests could not marry, so this was a very important condition. Bishops were the head priests responsible for all churches in the city. They were religious nobility, and they had vast estates, and they lived in houses which were as good as grand palaces. And what you see in this picture is a grand house like a palace of a bishop. Some deeply religious people, they chose to live isolated lives. Unlike the priests who lived along with the people in towns and villages, these people lived isolated lives and spending their time in prayer. These people were called, men were called monks and women were called nuns. And what you see is a picture of the nuns. Monks and nuns did not marry. Now that was a very, very important condition. They lived in religious communities called abbeys or monasteries, in places far from the human habitation. Now they did not marry because they wanted to devote their life to God and spend their time in prayer and service. So they stayed far away from the common people. They took vows to remain in the abbey for the rest of their lives and spend their time in prayer, study and manual labor like farming. So along with prayer, they also tried to work like farming on the fields, cutting crops. Some women did embroidery, knitting, stitching. Then they copied manuscripts. So all those things all were also done besides prayer. There were separate abbeys for men and women. The word monastery is derived from the Greek word monos, meaning someone who lives alone. So all those people who lived in these monasteries were staying away from their homes. Abbey is derived from the Syriac abba, meaning father. So abbey is governed by an abbot or an abbess. So he was like a father to all those people living in that abbey or monastery. Monasteries grew to communities, often of several hundred. So large group of monks and nuns lived, of course, in separate monasteries, with large buildings and landed estates. So they had huge areas of land which was given in donation by kings and other people. And they also had schools attached with them where they imparted education and colleges and also hospitals for looking after the sick and the invalid. Hildegard was an abbess and gifted musician. And so he is the one who has contributed to this system of community singing of prayers, which we see very common in churches today. So one very important group of monks were the friars, who did not live in one monastery, but they moved from place to place preaching people about Christianity. And also they lived on charity because they didn't have a home of their own or lived in one single monastery. So they lived on charity. So this is a picture of a monastery, and you can see on the side the different kind of work which these monks and the nuns were doing. They were carrying out prayer, they were preaching, they were looking after the sick, then they were discussing the religious texts. Some of them are copying down manuscripts of the religious texts, and some are also working on the field. Now this, you can see a monk who's copying down the manuscript, and some manuscripts were found with the Benedictine monasteries. And from these manuscripts, we get to know the rules for the monks. The permission to speak should rarely be granted to monks. So the monks were generally supposed to be quiet and spend their time in prayer. Humility for them meant obedience. So they would not ever disobey the orders that were passed. No monk should own private property. So no self-indulgence. Anything that they used was a property of the monastery. Idleness is the enemy of the soul. So they said that all friars and sisters are the nuns, should be occupied at certain times in manual labor and fixed hours in sacred reading. So fixed hours for their prayer and sacred reading, and other time in manual labor. The monastery should be laid out in such a way that all necessities should be found within its bounds. So it should be self-sufficient. So it had its own water wells, it had mills, it had garden, workshop, so that they did not have to depend or go out for anything. Now the church had a very important impact on the society as well. Christmas, that is Christ's birth, and Easter, crucifixion of Christ and his rising from the dead. These are two very important dates from the 4th century. 4th century is the birth of Christ, and then onwards they became important dates. Now Christmas celebrated on December 25th, though we all know actually Christ was not born in December. So he was born sometime during the summer. But in those days people were already celebrating a festival on the winter solstice. So it would have been very difficult for them to leave their old customs and traditions and start something new. So the people decided, the priest decided, that we are going to celebrate Christmas on 25th of December, and we will include the customs that were earlier being practiced. So in the older festival that they were celebrating, they decorated with wreaths. They gave gifts to each other, they used candles to signify light, and a lot of celebration was going on with music and other things. So these customs were included in Christmas celebration. Then Easter date was not fixed one, because it replaced an older festival to celebrate the coming of spring after the long winter season. So basically it was something like a harvest festival. So this date depended on the lunar calendar. Traditionally, on that day, people of each village used to make tour of their village land, because it was, of course, harvest time. With the coming of Christianity, they continued to do this. But now they call the village as the parish, the area under the supervision of one priest. So these peasants who were overworked, who had been toiling all through, welcomed these holy days of celebration because they were not expected to work then. And probably from that we have got the word holidays, where we do not work and we celebrate and we enjoy. These days were meant for prayer, but along with prayer, people also spend good time having fun and feasting with their friends, relatives and neighbors. Now just like any other religion, pilgrimage was also an important part of a Christian's life, and many people went out on long journeys to shrines of martyrs, places associated with people who had given their lives for their religion, and also went to see big churches. Churches were beautiful buildings with a lot of paintings and things related to the religion. So this pilgrimage was also a very important part of their life. So with this, we come an end of this session. We'll meet again in the next session. Till then, have a good time. Thank you.